for cities to be successful, you got to recognize you live in a world, you live in an international economy, and you have to realize that business is international. And so for a city to be anything other than opened and welcome to new people is a bad thing. And so in the sense of Richard Florida, talks about the three T's: talent, technology, and tolerance. And I think the tolerance piece is real important, because people are going to go to places where they are welcomed. And I always say this, and I believe this to the core of my being, that when you stop and think about an immigrant coming to your city, immigrants come and they have big selection of places they can live in the United States, 50 states, all different types of communities. And it's like Southwest Airlines says, you're free to move about the country. And when they select your city as a place to come and live their dreams, to seek their opportunities, to raise their families, and to put their kids in a position to have a successful life, and they pick your city, that's the biggest compliment anybody ever give you.
Said, welcome back to Massachusetts. We are very proud that you started out here and you went and you conquered Nashville. We feel like we've conquered the world in doing that. So tell us a little bit about your growing up in Massachusetts, in Gardner, where I believe you grew up, some of your early influences. What took you to your political career?
Well, I spent most of my childhood in high school and my summers when I was in college in Gardner, Massachusetts, which, for those of you who don't know Gardner, just go straight out Route 2. It's about 60 miles away. And it's a city with strong branding. It is chair town. It was the furniture capital of America back in the middle of the 20th century. And the world's largest chair is in front of the high school that I went to. It's a small town of about 17,000. I was there, during the early 70s was my high school time, and it was going through a transition. Lots of businesses were moving south or moving out of the country. The furniture business was changing, but it was a wonderful place to grow up. It wasn't a real affluent city, but it was located in a great spot. You're right up on the border in New Hampshire. You're 60 miles from Boston. There were things to do. It was safe. I thought I got a great education at Gardner High School. I had teachers who were outstanding motivators. So I feel really fortunate that I was able to grow up there. I have only fond memories of Gardner. My path of being in politics is I always had an interest in government and politics, and went to college in New York City, and decided I'd go to law school like everybody did during the late 70s. And when I was selecting a law school, I thought I'd spend the rest of my life in New England, so I wanted to pick someplace different. And one of the places that Columbia really pushed was Vanderbilt Law School. So I applied and I went to Nashville to go to law school. I went there sight unseen. I had never been to Nashville when I went there. And so I'm in law school, and I met a woman who's from Nashville, who's in my law school class. And it's the old story. We fall in love. We spend 2.5 years debating about where we're going to live when we get married, Nashville or Gardner. And I live in Nashville. In many ways, it's the best thing that ever happened to me, other than having a great wife and a wonderful set of kids. Nashville is just a growing, dynamic place, and it was a good place for a career. And my interest in politics there, I started work. I worked as a public defender. I worked as an assistant public defender for 7 years or so. And public defenders in Tennessee and a few other places are elected. And in 1990, the office was open, and I ran for it and became the public defender, which means you basically run the office and you still do some trial work. But I was reelected in 94 and 98, and then a former public defender who I used to work with was elected mayor, and he asked me to leave that job and become the city's director of law, which means you run the law department, you're the city's lawyer. And so I did that and enjoyed that, because you're right in the middle of everything, and it's a whole variety of legal matters you get to work on. and you worked very closely with the mayor's office. And so when he wasn't, he did his two terms, and I thought, you know, I was turning 50, almost 50, and I thought, if I'm ever going to do this, this is the time to do it. I didn't have, you know, I had some name recognition, but not a whole lot. And so I entered the race as the last person in, five candidates, and fortunately I won. And so that's how I became mayor.
All right. So clearly, you know, working in, you know, as a public defender and then running the city's law office, there must have been things that you saw that bothered you or that you were fascinated by, that, you know, that in a sense really resulted in your destiny as mayor and what you did. Can you tell us a little bit about what was your vision when you decided to run for mayor? What was your vision for the city? What was it in the city that you loved or you wanted to change?
Well, I think there is actually, I think my time, which is really 16 years as a public defender, which is a long time as a public defender, really shaped a lot of my views on things. And probably the area where it influenced me the most was education. Mm-hmm. You know, as public defender, you're representing poor people accused of crimes. Everybody in the world's against them. And our clients, I'd say easily somewhere between 95 and 98% were high school dropouts. And I'm not saying that that's the only reason you have crime because people don't have an education, but it certainly is a contributor. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, time and time again, you would interview a client, how far did you go in school? And it'd be 10th grade, 11th grade, 8th grade, and which really got me interested in education as what being provided in our community. I represented a lot of juveniles accused of some very serious crimes, and the juveniles that I represented almost uniformly were not going to school. They were just truant. They were just gone. Nobody did much about it. Mm-hmm. And they were sort of out on the streets, and you had, you know, I represented some very young kids accused of homicides. And again, that got my attention in the sense that I began to think that, you know, education mm-hmm. was clearly what we needed to be working on. So I ran for mayor. I mean, I really looked at what I talked about in the campaign and what I thought for the city is that the city needed to pay attention to three things. And these are sort of the deliverables that a city does and that I think should be the priorities. And I always call them the three pitches you got to hit every day. And those, number one, in my mind, is public education, which I think is in Tennessee is the number one issue for our entire state. It's certainly the number one issue for Nashville. And I think we need to be aggressive in terms of making progress there. The other would be public safety. I'm a big, you know, I was a public defender, but I'm a big believer that cities only work if they're safe. I think that, you know, you can look, teaching this course at Boston University, if you look at the history of cities, anytime they become unsafe, bad things begin to happen, not just in the sense that bad things happen to victims of crime, bad things happen to the perpetrators, but bad things happen to the city and the people don't want to live there. Mm-hmm. And they get insecure about it. Businesses don't invest there. Kids don't feel safe going to school. People don't feel safe going in the parks. Quality of life deteriorates, and then people make decisions not to be there. And so you can look at some, you could all name a city or a place that you wouldn't want your kids to go to, you wouldn't invest in, you wouldn't do, because of public safety issues. So public safety to me is something you never take your eyes off of. Mm-hmm. And the third thing that I really believe strongly in is economic development, the economy. And the way I look at it is you look at a city, and the city needs to be a place of opportunity. It needs to be a place where there are jobs. And then to do the things you want to do, which require money, schools, police, mm-hmm. parks, all the good things, libraries, requires money. And so it's, you know, to me, the conversation is better when you're talking about growing the pie mm-hmm. as opposed to how you're slicing up a pie that is remaining the same size or growing smaller.
Yeah.
And so a city has to continue to have a strong tax base. It's got to have a viable economy, and it's got to be a place where there are jobs. I think jobs are, a job is better than any government program. Mm-hmm. And so that's kind of what I wanted to do.
Okay.
And
I mean, you were clearly highly successful because you have been called a visionary. You have put Nashville on national and even international prominence. It's emerged as an economic powerhouse. And one of the things that really fascinated me as I was looking at issues on Nashville was that when you were looking to brand the city, you chose music.
Well, I didn't do all these great things.
Right.
I mean,
the city did, yes.
And Nashville has been a growing city for a long time, and it's had, I think, prior to me, I may have screwed this up, it's had a succession of really good mayors.
Yeah.
And so I came into a situation where the city was moving forward, the population increase was certainly manageable, it wasn't explosive, it's not the boom we've had in the last 4 or 5 years. Mm-hmm. But the city was in good shape in that sense. Now the brand is something that Nashville dealt with for a long time, and picking Music City predates me. We had gone through, and people here in Boston won't like this, but we branded ourselves for a long time, going back 30, 40 years ago, the Athens of the South, because of the number of universities we had. And we also had the Parthenon in Nashville. And it's better than the one in Greece because it's newer. So we
made out of concrete.
Well, it's very sturdy. It's very sturdy. And so when we began thinking seriously as a city about branding, mm-hmm. We finally got down to the basics. If you mention the word Nashville to anybody in the United States, and I'd say in a large part of the world, they're immediately going to think music, and music is our strongest asset, and we should play to that. And so we initially used Music City USA, and then we thought that was too limiting. We just go with Music City. And there was always this tension in the city where people thought that that some of the old line businesses thought that country music was not what the city should be identified with, that wasn't prestigious enough. Mm-hmm. Things have changed. People certainly now recognize that and applaud country music and support it entirely, but we're also much more music now. We're a major, there's Los Angeles, New York, and Nashville when it comes to the music business in terms of the infrastructure, the publishing, the production of things, that being the center of touring, and we're a major center for rock music now. The other video I thought of bringing is a great video that the Kings of Leon did for Nashville, but the Kings of Leon, Jack White, all these the Black Keys all live in Nashville, we have a great symphony, a Grammy Award winning symphony, lots of gospel music, bluegrass is big, it's all types of music, and so that's where you get Music City, and everybody now is bought into that, and that's who we are, and that's why people want to visit the city.
I mean, it's interesting because it's in some ways in some sense counterintuitive to the way people would look. Sorry. Actually, sticking a little bit.
Yeah,
no, I think it's stuck under the. Sorry about that. Yeah. Okay, great. Thank you. So it's sort of counterintuitive because typically, when you're thinking about branding a city, you go by the economic brands. You had the option of the university brand, and you had the option of the. The other economic development, I think you have medical devices,
The largest employer in Nashville, the most significant private sector of our economy is mm-hmm. healthcare. Mm-hmm. I mean, Nashville is the healthcare management capital of the world. But, Hospital Corporation of America was founded there. Tons of companies have spawned off it. There are about 250 healthcare companies located in Middle Tennessee. So that is where that is the largest corporate sector, but that's not going to bring visitors in if you call Nashville healthcare.
Right.
It's the music industry is different in that it just has this broad appeal, and people want to, when they come to Nashville, they want to hear live music, they want to be and see the music industry in action.
Yeah. So you've come back to Boston. You're here for a while, and you're watching how Boston has changed. Mm-hmm. As you look at Boston, how in your mind do you brand Boston? What do you think is Boston's brand?
Well, I think Boston, definitely the universities. I think of Boston as being a I think people see it as a dynamic city, mm-hmm. filled with history. I think the ocean is a part of its appeal, too. I think when people look at vacations or think about places to go or where to live or where to go to school, all those things are huge draws.
Not as exciting as Music City, though.
Well, I don't know. I mean, I think clearly the all the young people gathering here and mm-hmm. the strength of the universities yeah. is fantastic. And I think Boston's history is, you know, second to none, really.
Yes, exactly. You know, one of the things that I've often heard in the course of my career, Boston branded as, is a place that still cannot get past its history of busing. Do you think cities can get beyond their identities, you know, these identities that they have inherited? Did Nashville have anything that it had to get beyond that branding it?
Well, I mean, every city, every state, every location in the United States has issues, I think, that are related to race relations, mm-hmm. You know, whether it's in the South where we are, whether it's segregation or whether it's what happened here when busing occurred. You could pick any place and find something that that you're glad has changed or that is in the process of changing, because you know, things just don't change overnight. But I don't think Boston's unique in that. And I would say that, you know, I certainly remember that because I was a young person when all that was happening. But I don't, you know, I don't think that's how Boston is identified now. I mean, it's clearly, it would be on somebody my age's mind if I lived here. But when I think of Boston now, you know, I'm still a diehard Red Sox fan, so I think of the Red Sox every time I think of Boston. And let me also just throw out here for the Red Sox fans here, Mookie Betts is a Nashville guy. So.
Right. So, you know, sort of coming back to the, you know, the economic growth that happened mm-hmm. under your watch, there were a lot of signature events, signature investments that you made, you know, whether it was the Music City Convention Center or the, you know, the Riverside Park and Amphitheater, the baseball stadium. A number of developments that in some sense, you know, sort of led to what some called unstoppable growth.
Well,
in the downtown area in particular.
Right. I would say it led to needed growth and good things. I mean, mm-hmm. Probably the signature thing that we did in the first term was we built a new convention center.
Yeah.
And that had been something that had been debated and talked about for a long time. And I was, when I ran for mayor, I said I was going to do it. I mean, I was very straightforward about that. I thought we clearly needed it. I mean, we had a convention center that a lot, that was, in terms of its size and the conventions it could attract, we were competing with, you know, cities like Peoria, and nothing is Peoria, but other mm-hmm. but much smaller cities.
Yeah.
We didn't have a facility that was adequate for what we could compete for. And I was a big believer and that Nashville had could do a lot more with its tourism potential.
Mm-hmm.
And so I firmly believe that an investment in a new convention center was the right thing to do. It was a lot, it's a big project, you know, mm-hmm. hundreds
right.
of millions of dollars.
Yeah.
And it was a controversial project. It was a major lift for mm-hmm. us to do when we did it. Remember, I was elected in September of 07. And then about 6 months after I was elected, unrelated to my election, the country went into the deepest recession it's known since the Depression. And so I announced, you know, we're doing this project, and everybody said, well, you're not going to go forward now. And we said, this is the exact right time to do it, because mm-hmm. there is mm-hmm. nothing happening. And you're never going to have a situation where the cost of money in terms of the bonds is going to be cheaper. The mm-hmm. cost of everything in terms of the construction was going to be cheaper. And so we went forward and went through a long process of getting it approved, and we got it done. And, you know, to build the same building now would cost probably $75 million more than it did. And it's been, and I'm clearly biased, it's been a huge success. I mean, the tourism numbers for Nashville, and this was happening while the convention center was being built, have just gone through the ceiling. I mean, we have, every month after month, we break a new record. And, you know, the issue is how fast we can build hotels. It's
yes.
And so that worked. And, you know, the land that was taken to build the convention center on was land that was basically asphalt parking lots that was really serving no function other than giving people the ability to have surface parking right near to downtown. And so it has resulted in growth. It has resulted in hotels. It has resulted in restaurants. But it's also resulted in, while it was being built, thousands of jobs. And while it's operating now, thousands of other jobs. Mm-hmm. And expanded our tax base, and I think it's worked. My argument always was that a city's got to have enough confidence in itself to invest in itself. Mm-hmm. And I think that was a good sign of the city's confidence in itself to make that investment during the Great Recession, and I think the investment's paid off.
Yeah. I definitely agree. I think one of the smartest things, which we often think about development in times that are good times, and those are actually the wrong times to do development. You know, the American, Reinvestment and Recovery Act took the same approach of investing in infrastructure and investing in housing and public projects when the economy was at its worst. And I actually think that is the smart way to go. However, there are critics, your critics, who say that you invested in downtown at the cost of neighborhoods. And the way I look at it is that when I read that, I sort of felt like, you know, I think it is more what you do first and what follows later. And so I wanted to confirm that. If you had two more terms as mayor, like our Mayor Menino had.
Right.
What would be the
this,
next? Yeah. What? Yeah, I know. But if you, in hindsight, what would you? Would is there anything that you would have done differently to stave off gentrification?
Well, let me first.
Yeah.
I'm not running for office anymore, so I don't really need to do this. But first, let me say that I think that criticism is just wrong.
Okay.
I mean, I think obviously the attention is going to be on this mammoth project.
Yes.
But if you look at the investments we made, whether it's in schools, whether it's in new libraries, where we hadn't built one in ages, and we built libraries in neighborhoods, we invested in neighborhoods all over the city.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't think it's either or, and I don't think that criticism is even remotely accurate. And I wouldn't say that I would look at it as if, you know, clearly the convention center had to be done. It was a great thing for the city's economy, and it resulted in good things. But those good things did not preclude doing other things.
Yeah.
And so I think we took, yeah, that's the approach. It's not an either or deal. I just believe, as I began with, that the investment in the convention center is unlike an investment in a library or a park, because it's going to, I mean, they generate money because people come to use the parks, mm-hmm, and things like that. But the convention center makes a lot of money for the city in terms of expanding its tax base, which allows you to do these other things.
Yeah. I think that, you know, when I look at not just what this critique was about, but also what is happening in any growth situation, and I look at the city that I'm now in Cambridge, where, you know, development is pushing the housing market. Mm-hmm. And it is pushing the housing market to the extent that, you know, it's resulting in the loss of the middle class. I think the same thing happened in Nashville. The same things happened in San Francisco, and maybe not in Nashville. You know, I'm just going by what the critics said. There was some. In many big cities, when growth and development happens, some gentrification follows.
Right.
And the housing market is the one that gets more affected. Are there things that in your, you know, in hindsight that you would have put in place that would prevent some of that? I hear the criticism in Cambridge about, you know, we did away with rent control and no rent stabilization strategy was put in place. As a result, people are really hurting. And there's 31% increase in 3 years in rental housing, and at a time when incomes don't go up at that rate. So I'd just like to hear your thoughts about that.
I don't think you can compare Nashville to Cambridge,
yeah, okay,
or
just
Nashville.
In general,
let me answer. Nashville,
yeah,
to San Francisco.
Yeah.
I mean, when I was elected, I think Nashville's greatest strength in terms of economic development or encouraging companies to invest in Nashville was that you could look at the median cost of living in Nashville mm-hmm. compared to the rest of the country, yeah. and we'd be below it.
Yeah, and it's still pretty affordable by comparison.
And so that's very different than the other situations. And then you would compare to the median salary in Nashville, which would be above the national average, which was a great spread to have. Now, that spread, because of influx of new people, housing prices definitely have been affected by the city's popularity, mm-hmm. Has gone down. Mm-hmm. But we're not remotely in that situation. And the other big difference is, and again, I think it's all, you can never generalize about cities because, you know, Nashville is unique compared to these other cities that you mentioned, is that, you know, the area I was mayor of is 507 square miles.
Yeah.
Nashville was the first major city in the United States to have a truly consolidated government where the county, which is a real county, a big county, was consolidated with the city into one government. Mm-hmm. And so within the area that the political entity of Nashville, you have rural areas, you have suburban areas, you have real urban areas. And so there is lots of room in Nashville for further building. I think the issue to me, I mean, we have a housing challenge now. Mm-hmm. And I can tell you, certainly looking back at it, and I do reflect on my time as mayor, the most important single experience for me was a recession. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I mean, things just stopped. You had 9% unemployment. And I would say that the thing that motivated me most during certainly my first term, but I thought about certainly was important during my second term, was jobs, was creating economic opportunity. And I think that was the best thing to do. I think the new mayor, who's going to be a great mayor, that she is, she clearly will have to do more with some of these issues. Yeah. But I don't think that we're at a crisis point, but we're at a point where action needs to be taken.
Right. And, you know, I think another fundamental difference here in Massachusetts is the issue of home rule, where as a collective, even the metropolitan area does not plan collectively. So we don't, if we were to take the population of the metro area, it would be about the population of metro Nashville.
Well, our whole county would be about the size of Boston, not your metropolitan area, just Boston. We're about 650,000.
Yeah.
Our metropolitan area, statistical area, is about 1.5 million.
Yes.
Yeah.
So I think that is a key difference too. And I think the other difference that I also see is probably that the cities that I'm talking about had actually reached a level of growth and development that they're land poor.
Right. And we're not.
Yeah.
I mean, I think for us, it's a little bit different. Now, we have transportation issues where, I mean, if you have this big city and you can't get from where you live to the job, then that's a problem. And I think that's something we clearly need to be working on. And I think there are real issues about affordability for people who work downtown to be able to live downtown. Yeah. I mean, I don't think I certainly accept that those issues exist. But I do think that when you're comparing cities, they're awfully different. I mean, I think one of the things about what creating the metro government, which was done in 63, is something that we take, we really honor the people who do it, because that was a great thing for our city in terms of our growth. I mean, it created a much larger tax base. When people were leaving the core of the city during the 70s and going to the suburbia was still Nashville. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, we now have bedroom counties around us too, but our tax base is bigger than most cities. It's just a greater geographical area.
So talking about transportation, you know, which is, I think, an issue that many have heard about because, particularly the bus rapid transit project that you had launched in Nashville, which in my mind was, you know, a perfect example of how to achieve the access, the social equity, the economic growth, the inclusiveness, and the connection between all parts of the city. And the project got derailed. Tell us a little bit about it because, you know, as we are struggling with, I would say, almost a near paralysis with our public transit, any movement on our public transit system, which the economy and, from both from whether it's from the point of view of the economy or access to services or quality of life issues is concerned, is a big issue here. And yet we are able, we are unable to sort of get beyond it and, to find any solutions to it. Can you tell us a little bit about your experience and what we can learn from it and what advice you would have
Boston region? Again, Boston is so much further ahead when it comes to mass transit, and the northeastern cities are so much further ahead in general than southern cities. And for us, we have a bus system that actually, during my time as mayor, I feel like I'm running again. we increased the budget about, almost 100%. Yeah. I mean, we put a lot of money into it. We did bus transit, rapid transit light on different lines, bought new buses, expanded services, and then we wanted to take the next step during my second term, which was to do bus rapid transit, the real deal, with a dedicated lane. And we went through a process, and let me say, it did get, derailed would be the wrong word for a bus, but it did get, it ran into a ditch or something.
Yes.
But, ultimately, the blame goes to me. I mean, the Harry Truman thing, the buck stops with the mayor in this case. But it was a good proposal. We worked hard on it, and we certainly held lots of public meetings and lots of input. The key factor is we got the federal government, the Federal Transit Administrator, to sign off on the project. They were excited by it. And we made it into the president's budget, which I understand with budgeting in Washington right now, that doesn't necessarily guarantee you're getting the money because it's got to pass Congress and budgets don't get passed much right now. But we made it into the president's budget. And then there was resistance, and we expected, some controversy from different points along the line where neighborhoods might not want it or people would be concerned about losing a left turn. But there's also an issue that the roads that lead into Nashville, the pikes that come in, it's like spokes, are state-owned roads. And the state legislature then started looking at a legislation that would say that you couldn't take away a lane of traffic for transit. You couldn't take a lane away, which put us in a position where, the federal government is saying, you got to move forward. We're offering you somewhere $60, $70 million, I forget what it was. And, we couldn't do it without the state agreeing. And so that's what brought it to a head.
Yeah.
But, I mean, if you asked 10 different people what the issue was, you'd probably get 10 different answers,
yes.
But that's my answer.
Okay. Just in my research, some of it was the politics of what is happening in the nation right now, the sort of divisiveness of politics. That was one perspective. Another perspective that I found on that was that it was about race and equity issues. There were some perspectives that were that this was about traffic congestion issues. And so I agree. I think there are lots of different points of view, but I still, it sort of stuns me that, there is a good idea, like I think our, investing in our T system is a good idea. It makes sense from an economic development perspective. It provides access to people and, and yet we are not able to work it through. And I wonder from your experience if you have any advice for Boston and Massachusetts about what are some of the things that we should take into account.
I wouldn't be that pessimistic. This is, if you look at transit projects around the country in cities that haven't had mass transit, generally the first time out of the box, it does get defeated.
Mm-hmm.
And, particularly when they go to referendums, there's been a pattern sort of you lose the first time and then eventually you get there. There are other cities that have had problems with their state legislatures in terms of doing it. All states are different. I mean, Tennessee is a much different state than Massachusetts in terms of being a much more rural state. But it's going to happen. I mean, you know, I would say that the conversation as a result of this project and the growth of the city and other things is now at a point where I think the consensus is growing, something has to happen. Mm-hmm. And mm-hmm. no matter what the next proposal is, there are going to be critics. There are going to be people who are going to point and say, you didn't, you know, do this right or this right, or you missed this and that. But at some point, you got to do something. And I think something will happen. And so I don't look at this as something that is a huge setback for Nashville. It's a setback in terms that the transit will be delayed longer, but it will happen. I mean, it's a rational, you know, people will make rational decisions and they'll get to the right place.
So you think there's hope for Massachusetts and the T-system?
Sure. I think, you know, I don't know, I'm certainly no authority on it, and I've talked to people involved with it, but I think people understand that there's infrastructure issues that need to be worked on. You've got a system that, you know, clearly would, if you looked at transit systems around the country, I would assume Boston would be in the top 10. And people have to make investments and go through the political process and the debate, and there's always contending forces. I mean, I think one of the things people lose track of when you're in city government is there's always, anytime there's change, there's always opposition. I mean, that's part of having, you got to have a relatively thick skin to do it, because someone's always going to say, you know, I disagree because of this, and have some theory, and they may be right, mm-hmm. but there's always going to be resistance, and you just got to work your way through it.
Okay. So, you know, one other question, and then I want to actually open it up for audience questions, because I'm sure people have lots of questions for you. You know, given the times that we're in, and, you know, this whole issue of race, class, and identity, you have done a tremendous amount of work on issues of immigration, you know, your investment in entrepreneurship and inner city development and all. There's, and from, you know, from what I understand, that, you know, just like with most cities, and actually I would say across the nation, this idea of a divided nation. What role do you see, you know, from a design planning, you know, urban planning, urban design, architectural perspective, that this, the architectural or the design community can have to impact a city and to help heal race relations? Is there something about place?
The best example I can give is something that if I had to list things that I'm proud of that we did, was we built this bridge. It's called the 28th Avenue Connector, and it's not a very big bridge, and it wasn't by any means the most expensive construction project that we did, but I learned about it when I went to when I was campaigning. I went to a conference at TSU, Tennessee State University, where they talked about how the building of Interstate 40 divided the African-American section of the city historically from the white section of the city, so that like Vanderbilt and Belmont and Lipscomb universities were cut off from the interstate from Fisk and TSU. And part of it, and to get to those other places, you have to drive a little bit out of your way. And so I learned about this idea of building a bridge that would connect over the railroad, essentially to allow easier access from North Nashville to West Nashville. And to me, it was a symbolic thing, but also it was needed for transit reasons. It was needed for that neighborhood. And so we built it. And that, to me, is a type of investment that connects people. I mean, literally connects them by building the bridge, that neighborhoods become closer, and that, you know, people from Vanderbilt now can get to TSU and Fisk easier, and Fisk people can get to Vanderbilt easier, and that's a good thing.
So do you see yourself, I mean, if you look back and say, as a city builder, as someone who had influence on the physical outcome of the city, what are the top three things that come to your mind that you did?
Well, I mean, one of them that no one talks about and that is really important because it's not exciting is, you know, when I came into office, we had zero bonding capacity in our water department. You know, water departments are revenue generating departments, And so they're able to issue bonds differently from the rest of the city. They're issuing revenue bonds versus general obligation bonds. And because we hadn't increased water rates for a long time, we basically had no further bonding capacity. And the bonding capacity was important for replacing pipes, maintaining the infrastructure, working on stormwater issues that had been neglected for a long time. And so we did a massive hundreds of millions of dollars infrastructure program where we increased water rates. I don't need to remind people of that, but we increased water rates, and then we actually started a stormwater fee. And, you know, I don't think about it myself every day. That'll have a lot of good effects on the city long term, and it probably will be more money ultimately spent on it than the convention center. That was big. I like, you know, I love libraries to me. So I think, you know, if I'd say some of the library work we did was important, you know, I'm proud of the convention center. We built this amphitheater on the river. I think is a great symbol for the city because it's been successful. I love baseball. We got a baseball stadium. So they're all important. They're all different. It's all different. But I love being mayor. It was a fun job. So if you've ever wanted to run for mayor, run for mayor. You should.
I think anyone in the architectural or design or planning profession would love to be mayor. So let's open it up for questions. Paul?
Mr. Mayor, thank you very much for being with us. And you didn't say anything about the food. I loved the food when I was there.
Well, you know, that's interesting, the question, because, you know, one of the things that's happened in Nashville is Nashville in the last 6 years has become a real food city. And, you know, the government deserves absolutely no credit for this. But, you know, we now have chefs who have managers like the music stars do, which is a whole new field where chefs get agents. But we have lots of new restaurants, lots of old ones that are doing well. But it's become a city where people come to eat, and southern food is available. But because of the city's diversity now, which we haven't talked about much, is the, you know, Nashville in the last 10 years, 15 years, has really become one of the premier destination sites for immigrants. We have the largest Kurdish population in the United States. We were a voting site for the Iraqi elections, a very significant Latino population, Somalian. And so the food has also gotten more diverse. And so it really is, and you know, I've been sort of an advocate for cities being open and welcoming places, and it makes a city more interesting. Yeah. It makes a city better.
So I just was commenting on it, but thank you for that additional. What I wanted to ask you about, though, is you mentioned near the beginning about keeping your eye on three things, and we haven't talked much about that. Public education, I agree, is just such a seminal issue of our time. And here in Massachusetts, we're arguing about achievement gap and charter schools, teacher training, making sure that we have teachers properly prepared to teach STEM subjects. I'm wondering what your observations are and what you learned about what worked and what doesn't work in our current system of public education.
Well, first of all, I'd say that in education circles nationwide, Massachusetts is almost always held up as a standard, as being one of the best. And it's certainly, you hear more positive things about Massachusetts than I think probably any state right now. And sometimes it varies who's the top, but I think Massachusetts is, you're hearing the most about. You know, in Tennessee, our challenge is different. You know, we have real needs to have better performance, and I'm a big believer. You look at something like the ACT tests, which are, you know, the indication of college readiness. And, you know, we, as a state, we're toward the bottom. And Nashville is performing right now beneath the state. And so when I was mayor, I was definitely an advocate for education reform. It's another thing that you're going to get criticized for. But I'm a firm believer that you just don't keep doing things the same way. I got elected. We had three charter schools in Nashville. I left office. We probably had 27 or so, and they're growing. I think that's been good for the city, that some of them are knocking out of the ballpark. We've put a lot of money into schools and seen better results in terms of truancy, in terms of graduation rates. But we still have a long way to go on terms of the of testing. And I'm not just talking about I'm talking about college readiness testing to indicate whether we're producing kids who are ready to go to college, which I think is fundamentally what's going to make the great cities are going to be, and this is where Boston's strength is you got to be a place that attracts or produces college graduates and that you keep them. That's the cities that are really going to succeed. Mm-hmm. And that's our challenge. And we would be envious of where you are. But the debates are the same. We're having the exact same debates you're having.
There's a question at the back there. And then.
I seem to remember that Nashville had a terrible flood at some point. And was that on your watch? And how, if so, how does it affect how Nashville is thinking about where the infrastructure gets built and how things are done or protecting the city?
Yes, I was mayor. It happened in 2010, and essentially it was the worst natural disaster the city had in probably 75 years. We got about 14 inches of rain in 36 hours. We had flash flooding. All sorts of creeks and streams lead into the Cumberland. The Cumberland is the river you saw in the video. And the flash flooding resulted in 11 deaths, and then the Cumberland came out of the banks of the river, which it hadn't done in years, and you know, did extensive damage to our brand new Symphony Hall and to other buildings in the downtown area. It was a major hit for the city. I think the city responded fantastically. I mean, we had, I think one of Nashville's great strengths is people volunteer, people help each other. We had very organized efforts of volunteers working, and the city got back up on its feet incredibly fast. You know, the flood happened in May, early May, and we were hosting the CMA, the Country Music Festival, in June, and it went off very well. And that was sort of the ground zero where that event was held. You know, we have, our Nashville are continuing a debate about building flood walls, which I've been an advocate for. We have spent a lot of money on making areas, particularly along the creeks and streams, in terms of notification of any possible recurrence of the event, giving ample warning. We've made efforts to, through our stormwater projects and others, to make the drainage better and safer. But ultimately, you know, the big deal is keeping the Cumberland within its banks. And I think you can't do it all at once. And I think we need to look very seriously at flood walls. But I've never been prouder of, you know, I had two events in my first term. And remember, the recession's going on during all this. And when the flood hit, you know, it knocked out one of the malls you saw here, the Opry Mills Mall out by the Opryland Hotel, which was a huge source of sales tax revenue. That mall was knocked out for like 7 months. The Opryland Motel was closed from May to November. The Grand Ole Opry never stopped playing. It moved around the different sites. But it was a big economic hit on top of the recession. But I speak very highly of FEMA. FEMA did a great job in Nashville. The citizens were fantastic, and we were able to recover.
And you did a tremendous job from everything you hear. And I think there were some strategic moves, too, you made about land swaps and all that. Set the city up for success for the future. Can you talk a little
bit? Well, one of the things is, let me tell you, a good thing about the recession was there were good real estate deals. And so we did, we had the opportunity to do a public-private partnership with a nonprofit and a private foundation to do an open space plan for Nashville, where we identified pretty ambitious goals for us to acquire open space over the next few decades. And because of real estate prices being low during the recession, we were far ahead of where we should be. We were able to acquire and preserve open space at a much more rapid pace. It'll be more difficult to do it when the economy's humming and the real estate prices are up. But that's been a good thing for the city.
There's a question here.
There are several music cities in America. Nashville obviously is one. It's thought to be country music. The other one, or at least one of the other music cities, is Memphis, home mm-hmm. of blues and rock and roll. It has not done as well as Nashville. One, Nashville is thought to be a white city, if I can generalize. Memphis is thought to be a black city. What advice would you give to Memphis to sort of mirror the advantages and the kind of advancement that you have had in Nashville, and how can they kind of counter their differences in the two cities themselves?
Well, number one, let me start again by saying I'm reluctant to compare cities. I'm happy to talk about Memphis and Nashville where they are, but they're different places, and there's different issues that we each confront. I would, you know, if the perception is Nashville's a white city, that's incorrect. I mean, certainly our African American population is not as high as Memphis, but we are certainly not a white city by any stretch of the imagination. And I think Memphis has a lot of good things going for it. There's a new mayor. They have done a lot of interesting things downtown. They have some strong companies there. You know, I'm often asked by people from Memphis, for instance, to talk about the issue of consolidation, whether they should consolidate their government like we did. And I don't want to meddle in anybody's local politics. All I would say is that's been a good thing for us, and it's worked for us. And I wouldn't necessarily, I would tell you what we did in Nashville in the 60s and how it's worked out. And then it's up to the localities to make their own determination about it. I think Memphis is moving in the right direction. And I think they'll continue to make progress. I really don't see it as a rivalry between us at all. I think it's clearly in the state's interest, and it's in both Memphis' interest and Nashville's interest if we both flourish. In addition, we want to see Chattanooga and Knoxville flourish too.
And New Orleans as well.
And New Orleans as well, yeah. But Memphis has got a great heritage. I mean, Memphis is, if you haven't been to Memphis, you got Beale Street, the Peabody Hotel. You have a great tradition of the blues there. It's the home of the king. Elvis is obviously mm-hmm. his home is there. And I will concede to Memphis that if you go to Europe and you mention Tennessee, I've done this. The first thing you hear is not necessarily Nashville. It's usually Elvis. Maybe sometimes Jack Daniels.
Yeah. Go ahead. I had a question for you. I was hoping you could speak a little bit to the collaboration and the coalition building that goes on as a mayor, both within different departments of your government to get some of those big projects done, and also within the community, whether you're working in downtown with property owners or some of the universities and other institutions, or within the neighborhoods to help get some of those projects done.
Well, I think everything you do, you're looking for, number one, you want the government to be as user-friendly as possible. I think one of the things I take great pride in with Nashville is that I think when I was elected, anecdotally, you would hear from developers that Nashville was hard to do business in. And they would point to other counties and say, you can get something done faster there, or it's less burdensome. And we tried very hard with our codes department and our permitting process and doing sort of one-stop shopping where you can get it all done, not loosening the rules or playing favorites, but just being more efficient. And I think anecdotally, by the time I left office, I think people were saying we were about the best. And I think that's important. I mean, clearly, anytime you're doing a project in a neighborhood, you're gonna need to reach out to folks, try to persuade them that this is in everybody's common interest to work on this. But it's not always successful. I mean, I think one of the, doing the reading I do from my class at BU, I mean, I think one of the threads you always read is that there's always an element where there's some discussion. Some projects are just uniformly happy. or there's not an issue where anybody feels insecure about it, other than they might not think it's a wise use of public money, or they might not think it's the right investment for the city. I mean, for instance, the convention center had plenty of critics and people who worked and were financed and well organized against it, but their arguments were really not that this is a bad use of this land, or this land is some using the land this way is going to hurt somebody's business or hurt their neighborhood. That wasn't really an argument. The argument was more about why do it, or it's not going to work, or there's no one's going to come, things like that.
There's a question there, and then.
Hi, so my name is Wendell. I currently work as an intern for the city of Cambridge. And one of the things that makes Cambridge and Boston unique are the institutions, higher education, colleges and stuff. So I know that, everybody hear me? So Harvard and MIT are easily the two biggest employers in the city of Cambridge. I don't know what the employment numbers are for Boston, but I imagine that some of the major universities are at least top five, top 10. And people, top three. Okay, well, top three, there you go. So I know people are going to have some mixed feelings about the institutions and, you know, the kind of weight, if I may, that they have in the decisions that are made. So I know you don't like comparing cities, but I was wondering if you could maybe comment on what the public perception was about the major universities in Nashville, the role that these institutions played in some of the decisions that you made, and how you were able to, like, work with them moving forward.
I would say that the public perception of the universities is very highly positive. I think most people, number one, they are a very significant employer in Nashville, too. We have, you know, there's Tennessee State University, there's Fisk, there's Belmont, there's Lipscomb, there's Vanderbilt, and others. I'm going to leave some out. But they're huge employers, and they're a huge part of our economy. And they have been, certainly during my time as mayor, and I think traditionally have been very good citizens. I certainly had no experience where they tried to apply any sort of pressure or I mean, I don't think that there was a situation where they would. I mean, obviously they have interest, and they have, sometimes there's neighborhood issues. I mean, obviously neighborhoods get nervous when universities want to expand, and universities in some cases need to expand. And those issues get played out, and the city may have some role in that. But I look at the universities as largely, in terms of civic involvement, certainly the heads of the universities were great allies. I mean, I did an environmental commission where the president of Lipscomb was the head of that commission. He's been a great person for the city. Belmont, which is a really growing, dynamic school. The president of that school was very involved in helping us do the convention center project, which really has no benefit for them other than making Nashville more attractive. And Vanderbilt's always played a huge role in a positive way, and the same with the other universities. So, I mean, I don't think there's, you really wouldn't hear a whole lot of negatives about the universities from people in Nashville, I don't think.
I wondered if you could talk about how the city is going to use the open space, is using it, the different kinds of parks and how they're differentiated, and also just safety in the parks as well.
Well, our parks are safe, and our city has had pretty much for the past few years crime going down. I think we saw an uptick last year in homicides, but we hit 50-year lows in homicides in like 13 and 14 recently. So the city is pretty good in terms of public safety. The open space that we've acquired, most of that is yet to be determined how it's going to be used. I mean, we bought it with largely because there were opportunities. I mean, some of it we identified before as things that we wanted. One was a bend in a river. And we were able to acquire that, this big open space, and that'll probably be part of our greenway system. But the other ones have plans to be parks, but in terms of moving forward on that, you know, there are other things that are ahead of them on the list to be done. But we felt it, and I would still advocate for, if you have the opportunity to bank land, to save as open space that you want, and it's located in the right place that you should do it, and then you'll find the right park or recreational use for it. We have a good park system. We'll have a better one as a result of acquiring this open space. And I would say our parks are safe. I'm a big believer. Greenways are enormously popular in Nashville. I would say when I go to the grocery store when I was mayor, the thing that people were most happy about when people would stop and talk to me were greenways. They just wanted more and more and more. And we went through a long debate about it where people were worried about safety issues. And it really hasn't materialized. They've added to home values too. If you get a greenway in your area.
My name is Usha. I just want to tease out one point. Boston's very well known as a knowledge economy, seconded only by our sport love for sports. But one of the things I think that's really shifted in this community is its global sensibility. And I'm curious if you'd speak a little bit to Nashville and its potential global sensibilities beyond immigration, but what kinds of ambitions do you think a city like Nashville, which has been in ascendancy for the last 10 to 20 years, should be thinking about as it looks forward to playing on the world stage?
We have international business is in Nashville. Bridgestone, their North and South America headquarters are in Nashville, and they just made a large investment of moving their headquarters right downtown. They're building a new office tower to do that. Nissan is in our area too. Tennessee has, next to California, we probably have as much, if not more, Japanese-related business than any other state. It's been going back to the 70s when Lamar Alexander was governor of Tennessee. I think for Nashville, it's attracting companies and developing companies that have international function, and appeal. Our airport is growing. It will continue to grow. Our international flights are limited to Mexico and Canada. I think there is a true concerted effort to change that. We obviously are very interested in service to Japan, which would make a ton of sense, and service to Europe. I think the most important thing we can do, and the universities also attract a lot of international students, but the most important thing we can do, which goes back, I don't mean to go back to immigration, but I think this is really important, that for cities to be successful, you got to recognize you live in a world, you live in an international economy, and you have to realize that business is international. And so for a city to be anything other than opened and welcome to new people is a bad thing. And so in the sense of Richard Florida, talks about the three T's, talent, technology, and tolerance. And I think the tolerance piece is real important, because people are going to go to places where they are welcomed. And I always say this, and I believe this to the core of my being, that when you stop and think about an immigrant coming to your city, immigrants come and they have big selection of places they can live in the United States, 50 states, all different types of communities. And it's like Southwest Airlines says, you're free to move about the country. And when they select your city as a place to come and live their dreams, to seek their opportunities, to raise their families and to put their kids in a position to have a successful life, and they pick your city, that's the biggest compliment anybody ever give you. And we got that going right now. And it's not something you take for granted, because, we went through a phase in my first term where there was a bit of an effort to try to change that. But I think Nashville is a friendly city and a welcoming city, and I think that's the best way you can be international, is be part of that. We do other things like, sister cities and things like that, but being an open, welcoming city is the absolute key.
I'm just curious to hear what's next for you.
Graham's going to have me teaching a class on Thursday.
I don't know. I really loved being mayor. I really did. I was term limited, and I'm happy now. I'm fine. But I miss public life, and I miss. There are things I'd like to do, but I don't know. You just got to kind of figure out what's realistic, what makes sense for my family, and you know, at this point in my life, what do I do? And you got to look at things in terms of if you run for another office, just the reality of that. I mean, as I say, Tennessee's a different state. It's a very, the mayor of Nashville is a nonpartisan position, which is another, I would argue that is a good thing for cities. As Mayor LaGuardia said, there is no Republican or Democratic way to pick up the trash. Just pick up the trash. And so I believe in that for local government. But I'm a Democrat. I mean, I ran for public defender. I was a Democrat, and I'm a Democrat. Right now, Tennessee is very red. So, I mean, we'll see. I mean, I'm a very optimistic person. We'll see. I don't know.
There was a question back there.
I'm interested in this is sort of a two-part question. One is what the demographics of Nashville are, and then the corollary is, does the city have any arrangement, any agreements with the universities, for example? If the universities are large employers, is there any commitment on the part of the universities to hire the local people?
All right, well, demographically, Nashville's about 650,000 people. I think I don't have the exact percentages in my mind, but we're probably somewhere 17 to 20% African American, significant Latino population, over 10%, 12%, I don't know exactly. No, I don't think there's any agreement. You know, that actually was an issue just recently in Nashville. There was a, and I'll tell you where I came down on it. I don't know if people will agree with this. There was a referendum that basically said that any project in which the city was involved, essentially, you had to hire locally at a certain percentage. And I ultimately didn't think that was the right thing for the city. It passed after it passed as I was leaving, so it wasn't really my issue to deal with. But and then the Attorney General said it was violated Tennessee law. But we did on our projects, for instance, like the convention center, we would set a goal and say that at minimum of 20% of the businesses doing work on the convention center had to be small business or a disadvantaged business, woman-owned, minority-owned. And we exceeded that by, we probably were somewhere in the high 20s, 26, 27%. We did a deal as part of the convention center project with Omni. Omni did really a great deal where they did they worked with the Country Music Hall of Fame to double it in size, and so the city was involved in that, and they did the same sort of requirements, and they were over 30%. My feeling about saying to people you got to hire locally is that I don't know how you can, you know, it's just going to breed conflict regionally, and it's going to, I think, put you in a position where you're going to be hurt economically. I mean, our problem now in Nashville would be for construction, we don't have enough people filling the jobs. And then to put a limit on that or another requirement, I think, would be problematic. So that's where I would come down on that. And I think the universities take the same, the universities, if you live anywhere in Middle Tennessee, people commute to Nashville from other places all the time and work at the universities and work for the city. We don't require our employees to live in the city either. And I kind of believe that. I think you just let people live where they want to live. I mean, that's...
You know, it's interesting, actually, Boston, you know, and particularly in Roxbury, Dorchester, Mattapan, Hyde Park, that whole string of neighborhoods, there were a lot of issues about the fact that there was all this, you know, public infrastructure projects happening along the Fairmount Corridor, and the jobs were going to people in New Hampshire. So, you know, and the local people were hurting. The local I mean, if you look at, you know, in the issues of unemployment among African American youth in Boston, they're at a high of 45%. So, you know, I think from a community perspective, there is a valid reason, but the way that some of the neighborhoods dealt with it was to get very involved. And in the places where they got involved, because we had the same issue that, it was against, it's against Massachusetts law to have a local job. You know, Deborah, you probably know a lot more about it. She's was involved in the city. She's a lawyer, so so you may want to comment on it. But I think the way people got to that was more through local negotiation. And where there was local negotiation and local engagement, the results were the kinds that you're talking about, 30% and above minority hiring, women, you know, high rates of women. So I think it is. I think it's a real issue in communities, particularly when you look at the demographics of a community where there are high rates of unemployment. And the basic excuse was always that, you know, people are not qualified. So it's a more complex issue about job training and local involvement.
Right. Well, I think it would be great if a company or, you know, university or whoever or a city says we want to have a program where we're hiring people, you know, giving teenagers jobs or things like that. But my fear is that if you start having political subdivisions such as cities imposing local hire requirements, you result in the balkanization of a whole, whether the state or of an area. I mean, the economy that influences Nashville is obviously the national economy and the state economy, but in everyday sense, it's the whole Middle Tennessee economy. And the county lines that are so important to people in politics don't mean a lot to a business. I mean, people, and I really have a hesitancy to require people to live somewhere. I mean, we have this debate every 4 years in Nashville about should we tell the police officers, the school teachers, and the firefighters, and all Metro employees that they got to live in the city and pay taxes there. And, you know, ultimately, I would say no. I mean, I think, you know, obviously police need to be able to get there in a reasonable time, but they are employees and should be respected and like any other employee, and they can live where they want to live. That's my.
You know, the issue that that comes to my mind when I think about it is not so much from the perspective of the rights of that teacher, the firefighter, the policeman who is living out, it's and about their choices. But when you, it's about an idea that's similar to the concept of cultural competency, you know, where when you belong to a community, you have a certain commitment to that community. And so there is a value, you know, when people are living in the community that they work in.
Right. Well,
not to the point of being so geographically, you know.
Right, but I just don't think the government ought to tell people that. And so I think if somebody comes to Nashville, for instance, say you're recruiting, you know, teacher, we are recruiting teachers from around the country, and a person makes a decision to live in Tennessee and they're going to be great for our school system, you know, they may have a husband who, he's okay with living in Tennessee, but he wants to move to Tennessee because he wants to be more in the country, and that's what works for them. And I just don't think the government needs to let people make their decisions. It works out. Your city's compelling enough.
I apologize, I was a little late, so I don't know how much you already talked about city and transportation.
A little bit.
So I'm a Nashville native, and one of the things that my family's also there, and one of the things that I found really remarkable that you proposed was the AMP. And did you talk about that specifically yet? Okay. I don't want to put salt in the wounds, but I think the thing I was most interested about is it felt like that was a moment where the city was actually being asked to be something different than it saw itself as. And I wonder if you had any lessons learned from what happened with it. I mean, there were a lot of very complicated, but my perception was, I guess, in a way that the neighborhoods that really would have benefited from it and ought to have liked it didn't come out in favor of it.
Well, it depends. I mean, if you lived in East, this thing ran from East Nashville across the river to West Nashville. So East Nashville was totally for it.
But can you tell people a little bit about the demographics of the East?
Well, East Nashville would be younger. It's an area that's transitioned into, I'd say gentrified would be a word, but it's definitely a younger demographic. And then as you go up West End, it's more expensive, and people have lived there, some for a long time, some for not. you know, I mean, I think there's lots of lessons. And I think where we ended up, my sort of my final remarks I made on it just a few moments ago was that, you know, it'll ultimately happen. I would disagree that Nashville, that changes the way Nashville, I mean, a streetcar ran up West End for years. It is not a change in the character of the city in any shape or form. I think what it does do is, I mean, it takes away a lane of traffic, which for a city that is built on people having their automobiles and going everywhere they want, is a change. But I think it will ultimately happen, not whether it's that or a different form. I don't know, but mass transit is going to happen, and I feel pretty confident about it.
I don't disagree with you. I thought it was great. I couldn't believe how many people didn't think it was great, I guess, is what surprised me.
Well, there's a lot of reasons.
Yeah.
And there were a lot of different pressure points that came along, and probably really the one that was most challenging for us was the inability of the state to get involved because the legislature, with outside influences, basically saying you're not going to take away a lane of traffic on a state road, you're not going to do transit on a state road. But as I said before, I'll accept whatever blame. I was the mayor. The buck stops with me. But this is a process where the conversation is now going strong. It is needed. It's going to be more needed next year than it's needed now because the population is going to continue to grow, and it will happen, I think.
There's a question back there. Hey, Steve.
Thanks for coming here tonight, and I'm curious to hear an ex-mayor, former mayor, say, given that mayors and cities seem to be leading things that get done, as opposed to things nationally where it's very difficult to get things done, what are the elements of leadership that you think it takes a mayor to do to really make innovative things happen in a community?
Well, I think number one, I think it's real important to have priorities. If I had to say, that to me would be number one, just having clear priorities of things you want to spend your time and the resources on. And I think my experience is a good illustration of this because, you know, I get elected and we go into the recession and the pie actually shrinks a little. Our revenue went down 1 year during the recession. It's never happened before in the metropolitan government. But if you think education is the most important thing, as you're cutting up the pie of the little bit smaller pie, you're going to cut the piece of education either the same size you were cutting it before or even make it bigger if you can, and you're going to reduce the other things that aren't important. So that really guided me. I mean, when we were making those tough decisions, when we're cutting government, we cut everything. Most departments, 10, 15%, we lost through transitions and other things about 675 employees. We protected the priorities. So I think priorities are key. I think it's willing to do something and know that it's not always going to be easy and that not everybody's always going to agree. I mean, I think you should always try to reach consensus. You should always work together. But at some point, you got to make a decision and move forward on things, I think. I mean, those are probably the basic things. And then I think I would go back to this whole idea of looking at the city in an optimistic way. I mean, I think there's a lot of reasons to be optimistic in Nashville, but if I was the mayor of Gardner, I'd be real optimistic. If I was the mayor of anywhere, I'd hope I'd just see a good future and work hard to get there and have that sort of environment that creates opportunity.
That's great. Any other questions? So I just want to thank you very much for sharing your wisdom and your experiences with us. I think, you know, the Boston area is actually at a very interesting time of change and growth and development and planning. And I think all of these ideas are just going to be wonderful for us as we get involved in our public processes to make this region a wonderful place. But we look forward to having you continue to share your thinking with the Boston area. And again, thank you very much for your time and your generosity of spirit and your optimism, which is infectious. Thank you very much, and thank you all for coming.
simplest project has to go through 24 meetings, and all of that adds expense and time, and much of that is driven by what I would say are small-scale politics. Particular individuals in particular neighborhoods have a particular agenda that's all about stopping something from happening.